Just a couple of announcements real quick. You should all have seen this. We have our upcoming book of the semester, which will be Treasury's War. And that is Wednesday, the 23rd of March in the Harold Bealey Library Auditorium. You should see the flyer on that. We also have a very interesting session coming up on nuclear energy and proliferation. And you should see this with the Cyrillic. I've been told this says nuclear. I would know no different. But it's talking about the 30th anniversary. We do it in 30th anniversary if we have anniversaries for natural or man-made disasters. But the Chernobyl disaster was 30 years ago. And will be an interesting session on nuclear power and the issues related to that. This morning, before I make the introductions, I'm just curious, by a show of hands, how many of you have spent time in Brussels or in Belgium? How many of you speak either French or Flemish? So there we go. So we have some people who have familiarity. In addition to the ambassador, we have the honorary consul for Belgium in Utah, Patrick Didier, who's on the front row, and the ambassador's wife, Catherine, who is also here on the front row. We'd like to welcome this morning Johan C. Verbeke, who is the ambassador to the United States from Brussels. He has been here since January of 2014, having previously served as the ambassador to the United Kingdom. We hope that was a promotion, not a demotion. His diplomatic career has included working in the UN General Secretary in Georgia, several UN assignments around the world, including in the United States at the UN headquarters. We're delighted to have him speaking with us today, and I will turn the time over to Ambassador Vivek.
All right, well, dear students, I'm quite happy to be here at Brigham Young University, a great institution. I've been told that you are an alert group of students interested in international affairs, and I am happy that I can share some of my thoughts. I say share because I want you to respond to my thoughts and perhaps to disagree with that. And that is why I will make sure that there is at least 20 minutes or something like that for you to ask questions and give your remarks. A world in flux, strategic unease in a multipolar world, that is what I would like to discuss with you. And it's really going to be an overview of the world as such. We are not going to discuss Syria, Iraq, ISIS, the Balkans, North Korea as such. I think it's important from time to time to just take a kind of strategic distance from those peculiar crises and ask the broader question, what kind of world are we living in? And if you ask me, it is a world in flux. And I like the word flux, although it's not a very familiar term, because it reflects something about, in terms of unease, it reflects something about searching for a new point of equilibrium, of balance. And that is, I think, the point where we are right now. We live in a world of uncertainty. We live contrary, and I come back to that, to, for instance, the Cold War time, which was a bipolar world, which was a dangerous place, but a very certain place. Everybody knew exactly where he stood. Today, there is a lot of uncertainty around. There is a lot of unpredictability. There are a lot of surprises. Take just mentioning North Korea, what happened 10 days ago with both the ballistic missile test and the underground so-called hydrogen bomb test. Impredictability, surprises. That's the kind of world we live. And as a matter of fact, the concept of strategic unease is not my concept. It's the concept that has been used by the International Institute for Strategic Studies in London, which each year comes out with a booklet, a kind of yearbook called Strategic Review, which I would have recommended to all of you to read every and any year, but I have to disappoint you because just yesterday I got a notification that they had to interrupt that program, lacking funds. But I, as a diplomat, I've been reading that every year. And this year, they opened their statement with the concept of strategic unease. Now, the question that I would like to go through with you is, how do we explain that? What are the main parameters, the main underlying trends that define the world in which we live today? And the first thing I see is what I would call the diffusion of power. Power now is diffused all over the world. It's spread all over the world. And now we do a brief flashback to the past. At the time, and I go fast, at the time you had the Cold War, bipolar world. The bipolar world was a world where everything was quite clear. You were either with Moscow or with Washington. And you could make the distinctions very neatly. If you take the Africa chart, for instance, you take Congo-Kinshasa, everybody knew that Congo-Kinshasa-Mobutu, that was Washington. And then you just got down Kinshasa, Luanda, Angola, and everybody knew that that was Moscow. And so you could scan the whole map and always tell that's Washington, that's Moscow. But that gives a lot of predictability. That gives a lot of certainty in terms of everybody knew exactly where the other stood. And there was, in fact, just one big relationship to be watched, that is the bilateral relationship between Washington and Moscow. And that is what, why we called it a bipolar world. And as I told you, although I think that today the world is a less dangerous place than it was at the time of the bipolar world, today it's a much more uncertain world than it was at that time. And that uncertainty is a result of the diffusion of power, because from bilateral world, we went to the unipolar moment. Some of you who have been studying international relations know about that. That was when the Soviet Union collapsed, the Berlin Wall fell. That was the unipolar moment. That was the moment where there was just one superpower left, and that was the United States, the Yeltsin years. And that power then transited into a multipolar world, and that is where we are today. Multipolar world being essentially the US, Russia, China, Europe, essentially. I don't include the BRICS in that multipolar world. I've always felt that the BRICS was an artificial construction, a kind of temporary, opportunistic political agenda. Not that I'm critical of Brazil and South Africa, but I'm critical of the concept. And I never understood what the Russians came to do in that club of emerging countries like South Africa, Brazil. And as we know today, the BRICS are out again. So basically, we are left with four powers, but they are multi-power. And a multi-power world is a world which is much more difficult to understand. And that is why what you feel is that these powers are now testing out each other to know, where do I stand? When you're with two, you essentially know where you are, one and another. And you are more or less on the same level. Otherwise, it would be a unipolar world. When you are a unipolar world, it's very easy. There is one power, and nobody has to ask, where does the other stand, because there is no other. When you are with four, or perhaps even more, but four basically, the question is, who stands where? And that explains why we are living in that kind of strategic unease in terms of unpredictability, uncertainty. Everybody is just watching the other and testing them out from time to time. We see that, for instance, with China, who is testing out particularly the United States, but the Western world generally, in terms of what happens in the South China Sea. We see that with Russia, Putin, who is testing out the West again, Europe this time more than the United States, but the West, with the kind of issues they are doing in Ukraine, formerly in Georgia. This is just testing out how far can I go without going too far. So that's the first point, diffusion of power. Second point, fragmentation of values, dilution of values. Until 10, 15 years ago, in what we call the post-Cold War world order, there were kind of firm principles, and everybody sticks with the principles. Just to give you one, very prominent diplomatic principle. It's called the principle of territorial integrity. You don't touch the borders of another country. You don't touch the territory of another country. Territorial integrity. And what do we see today is that this kind of sacrosanct principles, this kind of sacrosanct values are being questioned, openly questioned, again, by Putin, for instance, in Crimea. Just run over a country, well, part of another country, and say the next day, this is my country, this is Russia today. By the way, he did the same thing a couple of years ago. Some of you in 2008 remember that he went to Georgia, went up to 15 kilometers out of the capital, Tbilisi, of Georgia, and just basically, for all practical matters, took over two parts of the country, South Ossetia and Abkhazia, with Sukhumi as a capital. So that is just upsetting those values, that is just having those values not take the same place as they had. It's what I call the fragmentation of values, the values being openly questioned. It's also the values from universal, they become particular. So there is a transition from universalism, human rights, for instance, universalism, to particularism. Human rights are increasingly being questioned, particularly by the Asian world, and being seen in a kind of more national perspective. The third big trend that I see is a return to bilateralism. After the collapse of the world, of the Berlin Wall and so on, there was a clear trend toward multilateral diplomacy. Multilateralism was the key for the future. And we saw indeed a lot of international organizations growing, both formal but also informal, like the G7, G8, the G20, and so on. And what you see today is that that kind of multilateral moment is fading away, and we return to the kind of old recipes of bilateralism. That is, we look at the world, each of us, just through bilateral perspective, and we deal with other countries from country to country, and not in the setting of common organizations with their kind of common understanding, their common basic values, their common charter, and their common outlook for shared values. So a return to bilateralism, which one could say is a more primitive form of conducting diplomacy than multilateralism. So I recapitulate. Where are we? Diffusion of power from bilateral through unilateral towards multilateral, and testing out each other to see where do you stand? What is my power? What is your power? Second, the kind of fragmentation of values, the questioning of values from universal values to particular values. Third, the return to bilateralism, away from multilateralism. Fourth is what I would call a lack of, or at least a reluctance to assume world leadership roles. At the time, you had people who assumed their responsibilities, if I may say so, and particularly the United States. The United States has been very often be criticized as mixing themselves with all kinds of crisis areas, political disputes, other countries, and so on. You can turn that around and say, look, the Americans, the United States of America, was a country that was one of the few to assume their responsibilities and kind of make sure that there is a global agenda that is being properly managed. So that's the other way of approaching the role of the United States. But clearly, there was a world leadership, and sometimes that was shared. And particularly, I think the US and Europe, to some extent, shared the leadership role of the world. You more in hard power terms, Europe somewhat more in soft power terms. But still, we assumed our responsibility. And what you see today is that there is a kind of lack of leadership, and everybody is complaining about that. We are complaining in Europe also of not having big leaders anymore. At the time, we had Charles de Gaulle, we had Mitterrand, we had Helmut Kohl in Germany. Today, in Europe, for instance, we are basically left with one leader, Angela Merkel, who even today has a rather tough time given the migration crisis. Now, if you look at the world at large, you see that other countries simply are unwilling or unable to assume that kind of world leadership role. Unwilling, which is clearly the case of Russia, they don't want to assume a leadership role because they are the first to infringe the rules of the game. And unable, I think, China. China may be evolving and is, as a matter of evolving, increasingly towards assuming certain responsibilities. We see that in their behavior in the Security Council, for instance, but they're not yet there. And then we come, of course, to the United States, and there, unfortunately, I must say, most of us, many of those who observe the scene as far as foreign policy of this country is concerned, we see a certain retreat, a certain prudence, perhaps over-prudence. You have to be prudent, and you don't have to be an active or overactive, irreflective interventionist, which was a little bit the case with W.A. Bush in terms of coming in and coming out in Iraq, for instance, without clearly knowing where you would land at the end of the day. But still, there was a sense of we have to assume our responsibilities. We have to act against the Taliban. We cannot leave the situation as it is in Afghanistan, in Iraq. And today we see a much more prudent president kind of retreating a little bit of the international scene, exactly at the time where we need leaders because we lack them in other places. And we have seen, of course, that kind of relative retreat. I'm not saying that the U.S. is retreating totally from the international scene, but it is definitely much more prudent in the way it positions itself in this world. So that I see as a fourth characteristic of this world, a lack or at least reluctance to assume a world leadership role. As a fifth trend, I see a certain withdrawal within the safety of the national borders, a kind of nations from outward looking have turned inward looking. And that's, of course, also linked to what I said about bilateralism. When you look at the world bilaterally, it's also because you are much more inward looking. You don't share your values with the others. And this is a result, I think, of a certain sense of uncertainty in many countries. Many countries lack the kind of natural confidence that they had in the past for dealing with whatever problems, both domestic and external problems that they have, and therefore they turn inward. People, populations, have increasingly problems in catching up with this world. The complexities of this world, particularly given the technological advances, are such that many people cannot catch up anymore. And your normal reaction is that when you don't are in a position to catch up, when you don't are in a position to properly understand the complexities of this world, be it technological complexity, be it political complexities, then you kind of return on yourself, go to the small, safe, local certainties of your small, local community, and then you see, of course, the rise of populism, of people who capitalize on that uncertainty and who try to get political credit out of that. But that kind of inward-looking trend is quite clear, not just in the world at large, but particularly, I would say, in Europe, where you see that countries like Hungary are definitely working with populist agendas, capitalizing on the uncertainty of their people. In fact, even inducing a kind of politics of fear so that you can better control your people and make them, again, local, provincial, whereas we all were talking about globalization, go global. We have now a go local kind of trend. That is how I see a little bit the world in terms of big trends. I recapitulate diffusion of power in terms of from bipolar to multipolar world, the return of bilateralism away from multilateralism, the fragmentation of values from universal values to each one's little particular values, the lack of world leadership, and a withdrawal within the safe, narrow boundaries of your small country, your small community, and that is where you feel good. And above that, there are some other, not basic trends, but new challenges, and one of them is, for instance, the hybrid warfare. As a result of technology, we see that the classical way of doing wars, of conducting wars, is disappearing, and that now you have much more insidious way of, you know, making life of your enemy very difficult, and that is what we call a hybrid war. That is particularly the case, for instance, in the ways and means that Mr. Putin is using to destabilize not just Ukraine, but even some other Western countries. He uses internet, cyber crimes, and that kind of things to make much more difficult. And that is also quite a challenge for NATO, because NATO is predicated on the principle of territoriality. Some of you are familiar with Article 5, which is the core article of the NATO Charter, which says that any attack to the territory of any of the allies within NATO is considered to be a collective attack, and everybody has to come in. Now, an attack on a territory, how do you define an attack on a territory when your country is being destabilized as a result, for instance, of cybercrime, which was the case, as some of you recall, a couple of years in Estonia. Now, from there, we could go over to have an overview of the US, China, and so on, but I leave that perhaps for you to ask under the form of questions and answer. But this kind of basic underlying trends is what I wanted to share with you as an introduction. And we have now ample time for questions and answer. Thank you very much for your interest.
We have about 20 minutes now. If you're going to ask a question, we ask that you come over to the mic, and you can just line up behind the mic. And if you would state your name and where you're from, it would be interesting, before you ask your question. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Brady Stimson. I'm from Boise, Idaho. And my question is concerning the recent migrant deal that the European Union made with Turkey. And I'm sure you're aware that the UN has declared that it is most likely illegal according to international law. And so my question is, what would you predict the ramifications to be for the European Union and Turkey and for the refugees that are there right now?
All right. Well, that's a quite an important question, because it's so much of a challenge for Europe and the well-being of Europe. As you know, we are living in a critical times. We had the Eurozone crisis. We had the Brexit issues, which I think is now more or less out of the way. But we still are facing with that immigration issue. Now, specifically on your question, which is on the deal which was in the making on Monday, as you know, the deal is still under negotiation. President Tusk currently is in Turkey to make some refinements to that deal. I think you have to look at it from a political point of view in the first place. And the legal technicalities, of course, have to be addressed. When you say it's being questioned by the UN, I would like to qualify that. It's questioned by one single UN entity, which is the UN High Commissioner for Refugees. It's not questioned by the UN headquarters. Ban Ki-moon has not been speaking on that. And as you know, the UN is a big, big machinery, and the UNHCR is just one little antenna in Geneva. So we should not give the impression, as unfortunately the press gives, that the whole UN has declared that that agreement is illegal. Amnesty International also has taken that point of view. Well, Amnesty International has a point of view that we are certainly going to address. There are some questions from a legal point of view, but the last thing I read before coming yesterday to Salt Lake City is that there is an answer to that question, and the answer goes to the fact that Russia, Greece and Turkey have an agreement on how it works as far as their dealings with migrants is concerned. The point is, you have to look at it from a political perspective. What is the deal here? What is the deal here? Of course, I agree with the subtext of your question that sending back migrants slash refugees back to Turkey is perhaps not a very sympathetic way of dealing with the question. But you know how the deal works. We send them back because they get into the European area in an illegal way, in not in a kind of proper way. They will go back to Turkey, but for any Syrian that goes back to Turkey, we take up a Syrian in Europe. So it's as far as the proper treatment, the treatment of the refugees proper is concerned, it's a zero deal. It's a neutral deal. For every Syrian who tried to come in, we will take up a Syrian. So from a humanitarian perspective, this is correct. What we do, what this agreement is aiming at, is making sure that the disorderly way in which those refugees entered Europe, particularly through the Balkan route, is now going to be an orderly process, where the processing will take place in Turkey, and as I said, once the processing is done, it's a Syrian refugee, it's not an illegal immigrant, then he will be accepted in a proper way to one of the countries of the European Union, not through the smugglers to whom they pay a lot of dollars and euros and whatever, but they will be brought to Europe with a plain, proper way to a country that has the infrastructure to receive these people. And that is what we needed to have in Europe. We needed to assure our public opinions. As you know, there was a drain, a lot of stress on our political system because people started being very much concerned about all those immigrants just coming in the country and settling down. We have to also respond to our populations who grew increasingly anti-migration, whereas in the beginning they were open arms to receive them. They become increasingly critical. You have seen that in Germany with the CDU and CSU being very critical today, whereas in the beginning they were with Angela Merkel in the kind of open door policy. We have to make sure that we calm down our own public opinions. If not, we can simply have a situation where the populist parties, and as you know, the populist parties very often are extreme left and extreme right, are simply going to capitalize on that unease among the population. So that's the political framework in which you have to look at. The two points are we had to address the political instability which was being induced in our societies and who could give rise to utter populism. We have to address that by making sure that those migration flows, refugee flows, are being handled in a civilized way, in a proper way, that asylum seekers are being checked in Turkey, get their papers, and are being flown over in normal place to Belgium, France, Germany, and not through those smugglers who take the money in their pocket and let the little boats float in the Aegean Sea.
Thank you.
Welcome. Other questions?
My name is Brian Lewis. I'm from California. I really liked what you were saying about NATO and how it's predicated on those territorial borders. What would you or Belgium like to see NATO do, and how would you like to see that role evolve in the future with problems like cyber warfare and the kind of those blurring the lines of those territorial borders?
Yeah. Well, I like your question because I think it's a very relevant question right now. And as a matter of fact, the chief of staff of NATO is very much thinking about that, Mr. Breedlove. So really the problem is NATO was being set up at the end of the 40s in the wake of the Second World War, the Washington Treaty, and the core article is Article 5. Article 5 and the whole concept of the charter is territorial. Now that's normal. War and fighting at that time was essentially a question of territory. We spoke about invasion. Invasion literally means you invade a territory. Can you invade through cybercrime? Can you invade through propaganda? It's not really invasion. So the whole NATO structure is predicated on the concept of territorium, territoriality. Now, you know that some people have been speaking for many years already now about the so-called post-territorial diplomacy. And I think hybrid warfare is a good example of post-territorial challenges. Territory is not very relevant anymore. In fact, geography generally, which in the old diplomatic thinking was where you started, what you started by looking is, what is a border? How large is the river? Take the Rhine River, take the histories of the Latin at the time of the Romans. What were the borders? The borders were essentially big rivers, and that is where the empire ended. Today, geography is not relevant anymore. It's other concepts that count. And the concept that increasingly counts in diplomacy today is influence. Influence which is being, in a negative way, carried out to destabilize other countries. And that destabilization goes through, for instance, cybercrime, for instance, propaganda, for instance, closing off communication channels by others and so on. Estonia is a good example. The whole country lay flat the day after the Russians had invaded their cyber structures. Your question is, what do you do then with Article 5? Well, I think Article 5 as such, you cannot change it. It's there, but in fact you should retranslate it. You should not speak about territorium anymore. You should speak about something else. What should you talk about? When we say an invasion against a territory is illegal, what we really mean is that you have to respect the sovereignty of that other country. And what is in fact sovereignty? When we speak about the sovereignty of the state, if we take that in personal times, not state to state, but person to person, you as against me, what it means is you have to respect the integrity and the freedom of that other person. You have to respect the fact that that other person will decide for itself what to do, how to frame its future, how to treat its people. That is really what sovereignty means. Now, sovereignty at the time was being infringed in classical warfare by sending tanks through the borders, which we Belgians know very much about because, as you know, we were a neutral country in the First World War and we were the first ever country in the world and in world history whose neutrality was broken. And one of the reasons there was so much sympathy for our country was not so much for the Belgians, it was for that principle of neutrality which was at that time considered to be sacrosanct. Now, what should we do in terms of today for Article 5? When should Article 5 be triggered today? It should be triggered not when the territory is invaded or not, because that's not relevant anymore. It should be triggered whenever the core sovereignty, that is the core freedom of action and thinking and expression of another country, is being fundamentally upset. And I think that's today Article 5. Article 5, we are not going to wait until Putin's army is in Kiev, or for that matter in Warsaw. We are going to wait until he has destabilized Warsaw or Kiev to such an extent that this government in Kiev of Warsaw cannot be considered to be anymore an autonomous, independent, freestanding government. That's the way I would approach your question.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, I'm JD from West Jordan, Utah. You mentioned the rise of populism in Hungary, and I understand it's also rising in Poland right now. How serious is the threat to the European Union from these populist parties in Europe?
Yeah, well, I sometimes I give as a definition of a good diplomat that he should de-dramatize issues. A good journalist seems to be somebody who dramatizes issues. A good diplomat is somebody who de-dramatizes issues. And I try to belong to the category of the good diplomats. And therefore, I have a somewhat more cooler view on the so-called populism in Europe. Although I hasten to say that I am very concerned by certain countries where populist movements do indeed constitute a danger in terms of upsetting the values I was talking about, from universal values, human rights, good governance, rule of law, towards particular values, my country, my little nationalism, and even, as we say, aggressive nationalism. And Hungary is an example of that. And as you know, we do have serious problems with the president, with the prime minister, Mr. Viktor Orban, who now has problems with the commission, and for that matter with the council, because he's not adhering anymore to the kind of basic contract that he entered into with the European Union when he was admitted as a member of the club. Now you have other movements in Slovakia, there is a tendency to Eastern thing. You have the New Dawn in Greece. You have Madame Le Pen in France with Le Front National, and all this has to be taken seriously. But when I say de-dramatize, what I see is that at the end of the day, they come not true. We'll see now what happens with Alternative für Deutschland, which is also a kind of populist party in the elections this Sunday. But until now, they have been rather weak. At some stage, they grew up to 16% or so of the population, but then they went down again to 8%. Podemos in Spain also grew and then faded away. And what you generally can see is that these populist parties are parties which capitalize on the unease, on the fear of the people, but that apart from that negative agenda, they don't have much of a positive agenda. And people start understanding that this is a kind of, you know, fake proposition, not a very balanced proposition. I would add to that that as soon as you give them responsibilities, governmental responsibilities, either they just disappear or else they become fashionable parties. So populist parties are doomed either to disappear or to become normal kind of functioning parties. They are strong just up to the point where elections come. Once elections take place, either they fade away or they become, if I may say, fashionable parties. And that is why I have a somewhat more relaxed view on populism in Europe generally. But don't misunderstand me. It's a challenge, for sure, and we have to watch them.
Thank you.
John Sutherland, and I'm from Provo, Utah, although 50 years ago I lived in Liège.
Ah, good. Hope you enjoyed your time.
I did. Given the migrant situation in Europe and the fact that they're not really adopting traditional European values, and they're the demographic trends. What do you see happening in Belgium in 50 or 60 years as the migrants become the majority in the electorate?
Yeah, well, the short answer to that is migrants, majority, these are not the terms of the debate. Migrants should be part and parcel of Belgium, should be Belgians, should be integrated. And then you don't speak about minorities, subgroups, ethnic identity groups, and that kind of things. That's the short answer. The longer answer is that this is a difficult process. It's a long-term process. And it doesn't just depend about the Belgian authorities, or for that matter, French authorities, German authorities. It also depends about the group that you're trying to reach out to and to say, look, you're welcome, come in and integrate. And integration is not assimilation, I hasten to say. It's adaptation. It's to feel part and parcel of our society, to identify at least with the core values of our society, let alone that we respect the values that they keep as theirs in terms of religious terms or whatever. Let me be somewhat more concrete. Belgium is today the most open economy in the world. When you say open economy, that means, for instance, that we export 85% of everything which is produced in Belgium goes abroad. That means that a lot comes in. You cannot bring more out than what comes in. You don't create ex nihilo. Means a lot of flux. I mean, coming in, coming out, not just goods, but also people. Belgium, I had the occasion to share that idea with your president. Belgium is a country where all the windows are open to the abroad. That's in our genes. We are an open economy, but we are also a country with an open mind. That meant that a lot of people found it easy to come, including Americans. We just have in Belgium, which is a small country, we have over 1,000 US companies who set their headquarters in Brussels. Belgium is, as you know, the center of Europe. We have the headquarters of NATO. We have the headquarters of the European Union. And it's not that we said you have to come here. It's the Union who said, look, Belgium, Brussels, is like the place where already most of the Europeans come together. And that is how we got the headquarters of the European Union in Belgium. The same is true for NATO. The Americans were looking at the map. In any case, it could not be the United States. Looking at the map, and they said, look, Brussels is like a lively city, a lot of cosmopolitan things going on, multilingualism, which we share with this university. As I said to the president, more than 80% of people living in Brussels speak more than two languages. Most of us are at ease in three, four languages. So that is how we got international. Now, international, the asset is you get a lot of people coming in and you work with them. The liability can be that some of these people come and have an agenda which is not propitious for your own agenda, your own country. And that is where we got some problems. Let me be very frank. The Turkish community, for instance, the Italian communities in the 50s integrated easily. Our former prime minister was an Italian immigrant. So easy. The Turkish community, which came in great numbers as well, integrated very well. If you look at the Antwerp Municipal Council, about one-fourth of them are members of the board are Turkish. They are in the national parliament. They are the local parliaments and so on. They do a fine job. They have business, a private business, but they have political responsibilities and so on. We have a much more serious problem, as does France, with the Moroccan communities. In addition, France has the Algerian community, the Moroccan community. And we have done everything. We've tried everything to make them feel at home, make sure they have already an advantage. They speak French rather easily. So there was not a language barrier, which was there with the Italians, with the Turks, with the Kosovars. And still, they don't integrate very often. We've been looking for ways and means to go beyond that, and it remains a difficult proposition. And as you know, some of those foreign fighters that we have, you have seen that in the international press, that Belgium and France were very much exposed to foreign fighters, to in fact serious threat against the national integrity and national security, were very often coming from these communities. And so we have to continue to work with them. But I wouldn't speak about, you know, ethnic minorities. I would speak with communities that a greater effort to integrate them is necessary.
We've got time for one more question.
Hello, I'm Lauren Vidler from Scotland. I was wondering if you thought that Belgium's position on TTIP had changed, like, since the municipalities came out against it, and also if you think the success of the agreement is, like, dependent upon the refugee crisis.
All right. For the last thing, I don't think it's directly related to the refugee crisis, TTIP. As the first, as regards to your first point, there are some countries which are rather critical on TTIP. Germany is the first one. Germany definitely is a country where there is a lot of resistances. But whenever you look at resistances, you have to look a little bit where they come from. We, for instance, as far as the government is concerned, as far as the elite is concerned, the business elite and so on, we are 100% pro-TTIP. And the reason is very easy. I bragged about the fact that we are the most open economy in the world. You can't pretend to be the most open economy in the world and then being against TTIP. That would be rather self-contradictory. So we are and should be pro-TTIP. Now, what happens is that, indeed, in certain communities, we have problems because they feel, they look at TTIP in a less enlightened way. Sorry for having to tell it that way. They should study their file, as you do, and then they would see that the kind of objections that they have against TTIP are non-starters. And I will say something critical about NGOs, but personally I feel that some of the NGOs who are very critical, because very often the people, some of the Belgian people, including the municipalities who are critical about TTIP, are so because you have some of those NGOs who are critical of TTIP. And when you look at it, it's simply not serious. They make a lot of noise. They do not know what you're talking about. But they have that kind of sacrosanct immunity. Sorry for being somewhat critical about NGOs. But they have that kind of sacrosanct immunity that whatever an NGO does is good, is nice. Whatever a government does is bad. Government is always there to be criticized. But the NGO, you cannot touch with your finger because that is not done. That is politically not correct. Now, as you see, I don't live by those standards of political correctness. I think NGOs very often act in an irresponsible way. They are not accountable. Everybody is crying all around the place, accountability. Accountability through the parliament. The commission should be accountable for what it does. The European Commission, before the public opinion, the European Parliament should be accountable. We all have to be accountable, diplomats. We all have to be transparent. And then you have the NGOs, together with the press, who don't have any accountability whatsoever. They can tell whatever lies come through their head, and they win through, in fact, they are more populist than the populist parties. They win on cheap arguments, they win public opinions for them, and then they say, hello, I'm a nice, nice organization. Okay. I close with that somewhat